in the context of 19th century science, modern occultism occupied a highly ambivalent position. The ambivalence of the esoteric formations that this term circumscribes, such as theosophy, spiritism, and parapsychology, is best exemplified with reference to the contradiction between content and form, or more precisely, between its knowledge claim, knowledge content, and its techno-scientific method. On the one hand, modern occultism provided an antithesis against the consequences of the Enlightenment in positivism, historicism, and Darwinism, decrying them as materialistic and seeking to enter realms usually considered outside of science. Occultism criticized their unconditional disenchantment, rationalization, and reduction of the world into thingness and utility. Occultism transcended the sphere of the positively given, the visible and the measurable, aiming instead for the invisible, the incommensurable, the hidden, and creating thereby a phenomenology of occult physical as well as psychic appearances. Exemplary in this regard is Madame Blavatsky's critique of contemporary science in the first volume of Isis Unveiled, wherein she polemically dismissed Kant's positivism and Darwin's evolutionary theory as materialistic and nihilistic. Against these moderns, she posits the occult sciences, which begin when the former end, or polemically spoken, fail. As she notes, I quote, "Modern science, eyes closed and its face turned away, stands at the edge of the dark abyss, separating the spiritual from the physical world. Stiff and firm, it maintains that the abyss is unattainable and groundless, even though it carries in its hand a torch, which needs only to be lowered deeper into the depth in order to see through its error. The patient disciple of Hermetic philosophy, on the other hand, has long since created a bridge over these abysses." Unquote. In a similar vein, Papus alias Gérard Encausse, in his Traité élémentaire de science occulte from 1888, defined occultism as the expansion of science from the visible into the invisible. And I quote, "All great men say it is not enough to simply study the visible, since the invisible is where knowledge's most valuable truths reside," unquote. On the other hand, it would be too easy to reduce occultism to its effect against the modern sciences. While it criticized the latter's reductionist tendency, it nevertheless took up their central methods and thereby also their claim to knowledge as such. The theoretical and practical tools of the exact sciences became part and parcel of the theoretical self-understanding and the scientific practice of modern occultism. As a matter of fact, occultism understood itself not as pre-scientific, religious, or mystical doctrine, but decidedly as a scientific enterprise which, using empirical methods and technical means, studied the occult sphere that science ignored. In contrast to mysticism, the invisible was not to be left in a cloud of unknowing, rather it was to be made visible and knowable, reduced to a formula. The guiding epistemological program of occultism is to make visible the invisible. William Crookes, as a chemist and member of the Royal Society, exemplifies this in The Spiritualism in Light of Modern Science, 1870, programmatically. And I quote, "I am convicted that every man of science who is attuned to the latter's exact methods is equally obliged to study phenomena which attract the attention of the public. That different physical phenomena, such as the movements of material objects and electrical discharges, you hear it, it's nothing spectacular that you can see here. Again, Crookes, that different physical phenomena such as the movement of material objects and electrical discharges occur under circumstances which no known natural law has been able to explain is, in my opinion, an irrefutable fact, much like the most elementary fact of chemistry, unquote. In Leipzig, the astrophysicist Carl Friedrich Zöllner, who visited Crookes in England in 1875, was studying occult physical phenomena as well. Using photometric methods, he proved the existence of electromagnetic distant effects between planets. What he had achieved as a physicist was then connected with the program of a transcendental physics, as he called it, which, taking the hypothesis of the fourth dimension as a starting point, thought to demonstrate, and now I quote Zöllner, the reality of a relationship between our bodily world and the different world of the spirits, which is invisible under normal circumstances. Unquote. While such a transcendental physics made the invisible aspect of the natural world visible, a new psychical research did the same regarding the humanities. The London-based Society for Psychical Research, founded in 1882, and the Berlin-based Society for Experimental Psychology, die Gesellschaft für Experimentalpsychologie, founded in 1888, among others by Max de Soire, are exemplary cases. Both aimed towards a decidedly scientific investigation of psychic phenomena. The Berlin Agenda, for example, programmatically states, and I quote, up to date, science, with a few exceptions, has ignored or dismissed the study of this admittedly seemingly obscure terrain. Only the recent decade was witnessed a turnaround. The scientific investigation of these appearances, their methodological and exact description on the basis of experiments, has begun successfully. It is science's duty to shed its light also onto this darkened terrain in order to remove wrong and superstitious beliefs, thereby truly fulfilling the goal of the Enlightenment. Previous investigations have demonstrated that precisely in this area of expertise, facts can be attained which are of great importance to science and, in particular, to psychology, unquote. So this is 1882. It's not now, but it's already then. Regarding occult research in the sciences and humanities, Papus remarked in 1888, I quote, "This study of occultism provides the experimenter with a synthetic system of affirmations open to scientific verifications and enables the controlled observation of ideas about little-known natural and human forces," unquote. Along these lines, the drive towards scientification led occultism to a strong knowledge claim. The scope of science was to be expanded, now encompassing also mystical and magical terrains. From an external history of science perspective, this may appear as a renewed amalgamation of that which the project of enlightenment had thought to separate. But in the eyes of occultism, this was deemed progressive. It wanted to transfer esotericism in the age of science and technology. Belief of magic were not to constitute the criteria of truth, but rather experimental measurability. As the Berlin Society again programmatically states, and I quote again, primarily, our method shall be experimental. The actual nerve of our investigation is to be found in the possibility of opening up the study of these obscure and extraordinary phenomena of the mental world to experimental verification. This is achieved through the artificial generation of the described conditions in order to then observe their effects, unquote. Autism's epistemological program, following the axiom of making the invisible visible, carries a basic media theoretical implication, which I shall investigate in what follows. Not only did this maxim provide the basis for a general claim of scientificity, it also instigated the application of media technological means necessary to make the invisible visible. In setting itself to the task to investigate experimentally the hidden aspects of nature and the soul, occultism turned towards technologies, especially new communication and media technologies developed around the same time. In what follows, therefore, I wish to depict how the epistemic maxim of occult research to make the invisible visible motivated especially the use of new communication and media technologies, partially even leading to their further development. I shall not, however, confine myself to occult physics, but rather to psychology, to the occult research in the soul. It may come as a surprise that precisely this field was not just restricted to experimental research, but also encompassed the use of media technology to demonstrate this occult aspect of the soul. My main interest, therefore, is to direct towards the use of so-called, I call them, soul machines. In order to understand these apparatuses, some preliminary remarks concerning their theoretical condition of possibility are necessary, namely, occultism's specific notion of the soul. As a matter of fact, occultism is not founded upon a theological understanding of the soul as something transcendent and immaterial. Rather, and quite paradoxically, the soul is conceived as something material, but not in the sense of materialism, which occultism has showed so strongly rejected. And yet, only as a material entity, in a manner analogous to natural phenomena, could the soul be investigated experimentally and made visible technologically. This double conception of the soul, simultaneously material and immaterial, in line with Gustav Theodor Fechner's psychophysical hypothesis, implies that the psychical contains an experimentally tangible dimension which consequently could be made visible with media technologies. As a matter of fact, the idea of the materiality of the soul is constitutive for occultism's research in the soul. Around 1818, this tendency found its culmination in the concept of materialization, which essentially laid out the ground for the ensuing use of media technologies. Alexander Aksakov, a journalist, and you know him, and Russian city councillor, who conducted spiritist experiments since 1817, before dying in St. Petersburg in 1903, is exemplary in this regard. He also was one of the first proponents of spiritism in Germany, where he acted as an editor of the journal Psychical Studies, Psychische Studien, which, as the subtitle suggests, focuses, and this is a subtitle, on the investigation of the lesser known phenomena of the life of the soul. Aksakov posed the question concerning the scientificity of occult soul research, particularly in the wake of Eduard von Hartmann's critique. In his writing on Spiritism from 1885, Hartmann a Berlin-based philosopher, dismissed the materialization thesis, which, formulating a psychological explanation, he deemed a mere copy of the belief of immortality, resulting from hallucinations of sensual experiences devoid of any objective reality. Although Aksakov took up this critique in his effort to treat Spiritism scientifically, he posited his animistic conception against Hartmann's psychism. He did this especially in his major work Animism and Spiritism, an attempt towards a critical examination of mediumistic phenomena from 1819, wherein, challenged by Hartmann's critique, he posited his scientific understanding of Spiritism. In this regard, the theory of the material soul, which attributed a psychic cause to the physical materialization phenomena, thus turning Hartmann's causality on its head, was decisive. Instead of nullifying the physical phenomena by treating them as psychic deception, Aksakov understood the former as material objectivation of psychic forces. This psychophysical hypothesis constitutes the starting point of his renewed notion of animism. So that's his notion, what is animism. And I quote, "The light began to dawn on me not until the attentive and critical study of the facts led me to conclude that the subconscious psychic activity of our being is not confined to a mere psychic character. Rather, it can transcend the boundaries of the body and has physical just much as it has plastic effects. This active force, therefore, can be internal as well as external to the body. We have here the highest manifestation of the psychic doubling. Elements of the personality transcend the boundaries of the body and manifest themselves at a distance, not only through psychical but also through physical and even plastic effects, leading to complete externalization or objectification. Thereupon, it follows that within animistic phenomena we have manifestations of the soul as a substantial being," unquote. Wilhelm Hübbeschleiden argued in a similar vein. Since 1883, he played a central role in the Theosophical Society. Among other things, he acted as the founder of the German section, as well as the editor of the journal Sphinx, which was launched in 1886 and carried the programmatic subtitle Journal for the Historical and Experimental Foundation of the Supernatural Worldview on a Monistic Basis. In an essay published in this journal entitled Objectivity of So-Called Materializations, he followed Aksakov's argumentation against Hartmann, however, slightly differed from Aksakov's account. He provided a physical explanation wherein materialization constitutes, and I quote now, objective processes resulting from the material projection of a force, eine Kraft, a force, unquote. Matter, therefore, is not reducible to substance, but much rather a relation between substance and force. It was above all in this dynamic theory of matter that Hübbeschleiden saw a correspondence with, and I quote, contemporary science, and I quote, "Accordingly, everything we experience is just force, and what we call substance is just our spatial, that is, three-dimensional imagination, which we construct from experiences of the effects of certain forces," unquote. Albert von Schreck-Notzing, who together with Hübbeschleiden and Karl Duprel founded the Psychological Society in Munich in 1886, which is actually the continuation of the London and the Berlin Society, took up the concept of materialization in 1914. Albert Einstein's theory of the equivalence of mass and energy, developed in 1905, further strengthens Schreck-Nonzig's assertion of the importance of the connection between substance and force for the occult theory of the soul. As he notes in his Phenomena of Materialization, I quote, "Modern physics sees in matter a form of movement and is grounded by the notion of energy," unquote. In front of this new physical background, he defined materialization as kinetic transformation, that is, and I quote, "as temporary changes in the aggregate condition of matter, whereby fleeting formations emerge whose matter is not durable, but phantom-like. It contains the minimum amount of substance and the maximum amount of energy," unquote. The above-mentioned doctorate in philosophy, Carl Duprel, used an analogous theory, a similar theory, framing it under the notion of monism. In 1886, he presented his theory of the material soul, formulating the path-breaking hypothesis of the astral body, wherein he took up Aristotle's notion of the soul as energy or entelechy of matter. According to Duprel's experimental metaphysics, as he calls his science, the astral body is a material expression of force. The materiality of the astral body, however, is not fixed or static. Rather, it forms, I quote, "a subtle etheric body," an etherischer Körper. The measure of solidity or volatility of the spiritual embodiment is determinable spatially and temporally. A solid body is durable. That which also Duprel designates as materialization, however, is of short duration. Thus, this material can be imagined in the sense of not yet entirely solid protein creatures, Proteingeschöpfe, as he calls it. And I quote, "Rather, one has to admit that the material necessary for the expression of the soul can also be different, much like the artist, who may show his capacity to form in clay, plaster, or marble, and that his expression can happen even easier in a short time. To me, this seems to be the only way to grasp an understanding of this mystical phenomenon called materialization," unquote. Occultism, therefore, directs its attention towards those energetic forms of the soul out of which refined etheric and temporal substances arise, that is, the whole range of psychophysical phenomena. This theory of the material soul not only enabled the hybrid transcendental empiricism of the occult research, but also the application of media technological means, to which we shall now turn. The idea of materiality is necessary for the practice of making the invisible visible. The invisible can be shown only the soul machines gain central importance, taking on the shape of amplifiers that can perceive these volatile and highly energetic soul substances.
Однако качество этой медийности в соответствии с материальностью текучих процессов является исключительной. Сама по себе душа, душевная материя, несет неопределенность, которая еще больше увеличивается в силу медийности. И здесь медийно-технические средства, которые усиливают природную физическую материальность, вступают в игру. Соответственно, машины для духа приобретают основное значение – поскольку они превращаются в своего рода усилители, которые могут воспринимать эти волатильные, текучие, высокоэнергетические субстанции души.
Just a question for the procedure. I mean, this will take twice as long or even longer.
Все, наверное, понимают, что, учитывая, что это несинхронный перевод, понадобится вдвое больше времени.
I was just suggesting that maybe you condense a little bit.
Oh, no. Not for me. Он предложил мне это тезисно излагать. Я говорю, нет, это надо быть специалистом.
Okay, sorry.
Нет, okay.
Occultism's application of new techno-media considered especially useful to the task of recording the etheric materiality of the soul was complementary on par with the current zeitgeist and not opposed to running against it. It profited greatly from the media technological developments in the 19th century.
Применение оккультизма с точки зрения новой техномедийности особенно полезно с точки для того, чтобы регистрировать эфирную материальность души одновременно с текущим зайтгейстом, в отличие от движения в противоположном направлении. Этому особенно способствовали технологические разработки 19 века.
As a matter of fact, the 19th century witnessed a continuous technologization of media. A vast array of technomedia emerged, opening up fundamentally new possibilities of communication, science and art. Typewriter, telegraphy, telephone, photography, phonography, movies, just to name the most important.
Фактически в 19 веке наблюдалась непрерывная технологизация медийных средств. Возник огромный спектр техномедийных средств, которые открывали новые возможности для связи, для науки и искусства. Это и пишущие машинки, телеграф, телефон, фотография, фонограф, кинофильмы, только самое основное я здесь назвал.
Since around 1800, to briefly display this historical context, different techniques with which the typewriter was developed began to replace handwriting. Since 1865, the Danish Manning Hansen, a writing ball with which Nietzsche wrote, became one of the first typewriters to be distributed in greater numbers. In 1876, the American arm manufacturer Remington was the first to industrially produce a typewriter.
Начиная где-то с 1800 года, я хочу вам дать сейчас исторический контекст, стали появляться технологии, которые привели к созданию пишущей машины на смену письму от руки. С 1865 года датчанин Малик Хансен изобрел пишущий шарик, который использовал и Ницше. И это стало одним из первых пишущих машинок, которая стала выпускаться в больших объемах. В 1876 году американский производитель оружия Remington первым начал выпускать в промышленных масштабах пишущие машинки. И с 1885 года пишущая машинка приобрела свою нынешнюю стандартную форму.
The technologization of writing and communication was further enhanced by the development of telegraphy, which following Samuel Morse's invention of the single wire telegraph in 1837 ran through cable networks. And around the end of the 19th century, these were then replaced by radio transmission. David Hughes's electrical printing telegraph, invented in 1855, also played an important role. Unlike the Morse telegraph, it automatically printed a directly readable text at both ends of the communication line.
Технологизация письма и связи еще, еще более получила толчок для развития благодаря телеграфии, которая после того, как Самуэль Морзе изобрел телеграф однопроволочный в 1137 году, стала действовать на основе кабельных сетей. И где-то в конце 19 века на смену им пришла радиопередача. Дэвид Хьюз, который изобрел в 1055 году электрический печатающий телеграф, также сыграл большую роль в дальнейшей технологизации. В отличие от телеграфа по азбуке Морзе, здесь печатались автоматически непосредственно читаемые тексты на обеих концах линии связи.
Nevertheless, I shorten a little bit now, so I would have a little bit more detail showed this, some examples in development of phonography and the cinetoscope. But,
уважаемый лектор сократил несколько свое выступление, он потом приведет, у него там были примеры развития фотографии, фонографа и так далее, но он сейчас это выкинул.
Okay.
Which part now? Which page?
Almost the entire range, it's about one page skipped.
Which page now in your case?
I don't have no.
It's
almost the entire range, it's about one.
Almost?
Almost.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I see. Okay.
I see.
So,
okay.
These examples would have been also interesting with the slides, but we skipped them. So almost.
Поскольку это все было связано со слайдами, которые он должен был проецировать.
Almost the entire range of these media technological developments taking found their productive application in occultism. Occultism and the proponents of novel technological media alike all seem to have shared the conviction that the invisible could be made readable, visible, or hearable, that distant texts, voices, and pictures could be transmitted, as Marshall McLuhan exemplified, referring to the notion of the magic channels, the metaphor of magic not only pertained to occultism.
Почти весь спектр технического развития начал применяться в оккультизме. Оккультизм и те, кто стремился к внедрению технических средств, казалось, что все разделяют убеждение, что невидимое можно сделать читаемым, видимым и слышимым. И что тексты, голоса и картинки, которые находятся на определенном расстоянии от получателя, можно передавать на это расстояние. Как в примере, который привел Маршал Маклюэн, говоря о понятии магических каналов, метафора магии относится не только к оккультизму.
In a moment of euphoria, this technologization of the media was not only understood as an extension of the human sensual organs, but also as a new form of magic in the age of technology. Consequently, occultism could all too easily declare this process part and parcel of its own program. Also regarding its object of study, these new media technologies seemed appropriate, especially to the task of registering the barely visible, highly energetic, etheric soul matter, and of recording and reproducing the communication which transcended temporal-spatial dimensions.
В момент эйфории эта технологизация средств связи была не только рассматривалась как расширение органов чувств, новой формой магического в эру технологии. И, соответственно, оккультизм также мог легко объявить этот процесс составной частью своей программы. И также, что касается его объекта исследований, эти новые средства казались совершенно соответствующими, особенно с точки зрения регистрации едва видимого высокоэнергетического эфирного вещества души, и для того, чтобы записывать и воспроизводить связь, которая при которая переходит через временные и пространственные измерения.
Techniques such as spirit writing and or spirit photography exemplify the importance of technomedia, especially for spiritism. Spirit photography became known through William Mumler's double exposure, whose aim it was, as he notes in his book Spirit Photography, to photograph, and I quote, the media's invisible double for the outer eye.
Такие технологии, как спиритическое письмо.
Around the same time, Crookes took photos of the phantom Katie King, and John Batty, together with the medium Mr. Buckland, developed the so-called transcendental photography, which captured abstract light phenomena.
Где-то в то же самое время Crookes.
Thereby and against critics like Hartmann, photography lent technical support to Spiritism's knowledge claim by making it accessible to experimental verification. Hüppe Schleiden, for example, argued along these lines. In his above-mentioned essay, The Objectivity of So-Called Materializations, he posited further media techniques next to photography, some of which were physical, such as the weighting of matter. And then I quote after that.
И таким образом, вопреки критикам типа Хартмана, фотография придала техническую поддержку тем претензиям спиритизма, которые говорили о возможности экспериментальной. Следует цитата.
Now comes the quote. Dr. von Hartmann rightly states that to give proof of the objectivity of given process. Of a given process, the latter must have lasting effects on the external material world. By way of photographic images, imprints on appropriate materials, or phonographs, sensual experiences must be captured. The movements of objects before and after the mediumistic impact must be undoubtedly asserted, excluding any sense of illusion. To these methods of proof, Aksakov also adds the weighing of materialized forms, unquote.
Dr. von Hartmann.
Based on the spiritist hypothesis, according to which occult phenomena are spiritual expressions, technomedia acquired a singular status in spiritism. They were considered capable, in particular, of recording the fleeting materiality of these energetic appearances carrying otherworldly messages that emerge from the world of spirits.
На основе этой спиритической гипотезы, в соответствии с которой скрытые явления являются выражением духов, техномедийные средства приобрели единственное свое уникальное место в спиритизме. Они считались способными в чат.
Merely confined to the scope of the spiritistic hypothesis, which was shared among theosophists but not among all occultist groups, these new technomedia found applications in other fields as well. This holds especially for parapsychology, which understood the materialization phenomena as physical manifestations of a latent psychic force, a force which Duprel and de Soir labeled the unconscious, das Unbewusste.
Они были ограничены не только сознательным.
Thus, otherworldly voices were to spiritism what expressions of an unconscious were to parapsychology. Particularly with regard to the latter, media technological apparatuses which registered the hidden psychic forces found application.
И таким образом, голоса, в частности, что касается парапсихологии, то технические средства, которые существовали, регистрировали скрытые психические силы, и это было там использовано.
Apart from the development of mediumistic writing, Spiritism and Theosophy were particularly interested in the application of techno images. Psychic research, on the other hand, promoted the development of writing technologies. For example, Dupré's transcendental experimental psychology, developed in the context of the Munich-based society, and which opened up the experimental study of paranormal status of the soul, such as somnambulism, telepathy, and hypnotism, implied that the unconscious was decipherable, like a form of writing.
Помимо разработки медиумных текстов, спиритизм и теософия особенно проявляли особый интерес к применению технических образов. Исследование психической деятельности, с другой стороны, способствовали развитию технологии записи. Например, Дюпрель разработал трансцендентальную экспериментальную психологию в контексте общества, психологического общества, работавшего в Мюнхене, которое положило начало экспериментальному исследованию паранормальных состояний души, таких как сомнамбулизм, телепатия и гипнотизм, подразумевавшие, что бессознательное можно расшифровать в форме писания.
This was, according to Duprel, the underlying assumption of automatic writing. And I quote the text from 1891. Automatic writing seems to pertain to a category of phenomena whereby our unconscious is drawn to the surface and hence rendered open to increased specification, unquote. Moreover, his use of technical metaphors, comparing the work of psychic research to that of a plummet, which is lowered through the peripheral layers into the latent depths of the unconscious, already hints towards the application of media technologies.
Это, по мнению Дюпреля, являлось основной предпосылкой так называемого автоматического письма. Далее цитата. Автоматическое письмо, по-видимому, относится к категории явлений, в ходе которых бессознательное выводится на поверхность и таким образом открывается для уточнения. Более того, использование технических метафор у него приводит к сравнению исследований психики, в результате которых снижаются уровни, периферийные уровни, и можно дойти до латентных глубин бессознательного. И это является уже, это подводит нас к использованию медийных технологий.
The development of the latter was not, however, just Duprel's achievement, but rather that of a barely researched colleague, namely Gustav Gessmann, who constructed a whole park of soul machines. At once a technician and occultist, he harbored the perfect prerequisite. After studying chemistry at the Technical Institute in Vienna, he worked as an official military technician and photographer.
И эта разработка была не просто достижением Дюпреля, но скорее это было связано с работой его коллеги Густава Гессмана, который создал целый парк таких машин для передачи души. И одновременно, будучи человеком технических устремлений и оккультистом, он создал все необходимые предпосылки для этого. Изучив химию в Техническом институте Вены, он работал в качестве официального военного специалиста и фотографа. Далее, где-то в 1885 году, он начал публиковать различные работы по оккультизму, под псевдонимом Мането. Это имя древнего египетского автора, рассказывавшего о богах.
Okay, I think now you were ahead, but no problem. You said that furthermore, around 1885, he began proliferating as a highly productive occultist writer, publishing works under the pseudonym Manetho, the name of the ancient Egyptian writer of the gods. He submitted papers to Hippeschleiden's Things and Aksakov's Psychical Studies, and published a number of books on topics ranging from occultism to magnetism, hypnosis, astrology, and spiritism. In 1890, carrying the title From Supersensuous Spheres, he furnished an encyclopedic overview of occultism.
Он представил свои работы в журнал «ESSWE» и в журнал «Психические исследования» Аксакова и опубликовал ряд книг по темам в самом широком диапазоне от оккультизма до магнетизма, гипноза, астрологии и спиритизма. В 1990 году под названием «От сверхчувственных сфер» он придал свой энциклопедический обзор оккультизма. В этой работе также была глава о психофизических проявлениях, которые он разработал далее в работе «Психография».
Yeah, that's what you said. This compendium also contained a chapter on psychophysical manifestation, an area that he further developed, especially in his work on psychography. Here, in particular, Gessmann, the technician, proliferated as a creative developer of media technological apparatuses. Psychography was not to be mistaken for the spirit hypothesis, rather, as he noted, it pertained to parapsychology, and I quote, "The term psychography or soul writing refers to the capacity of some people to bring to the force expressions of a psychic activity to which the state of normal consciousness does not seem to contribute," unquote.
В этой своей работе «Психография»
Gessmann thereby formulated a crucial media technological distinction. He distinguished between direct and indirect psychography. Direct psychography essentially refers to automatic and mediumistic writing or drawing without technical means. That is, it functions only through human and bodily media. The passive and preconscious body of the medium thus serves as a psychophysical recording device.
И таким образом Гессман сформулировал основное отличие медийно-технологического подхода. Он проводил различия между прямой и непрямой психографией. Прямая психография в целом относится к автоматическому медиумному записи или же к черчению без использования технических средств. Таким образом, это основано только на человеческом и телесном воплощении. Что касается пассивного и досознательного тела медиума, оно выступает в качестве психофизического записывающего устройства.
I skipped the quote. Okay. Yeah. Indirect psychography, however, constituting Gessmann's main interest, expands the human body with technical means. In the language of media theory, this entails an extension of the limited sensual organs. In Gessmann's typology of indirect psychography, the table of the spiritists, constituting a writing apparatus that records beating sounds, is just a preliminary step, which he describes as, and I quote, "a telegraphic exchange with the spirits."
Опосредованная психография, в свою очередь, представляла наибольший интерес для Гессмана по типологии гестебиения и является предварительным шагом, который описывает телеграфный обмен между спиритами. Соответственно, небольшая таблица под названием «Планшет» является самым простым прогрессивным способом для создания такого записывающего устройства.
Okay, and I skipped a quote also. Mm-hmm. what you just said is that also the planchette, the so-called the small table, constitutes a very simple advancement of the basic recording device of the spiritist table. Until then, Gessmann is still within the scope of mediumistic writing, whose technological possibilities Spiritism has had probed on multiple occasions. This holds also for the third variant, the inquisitive method he labeled typology. It constitutes of a paper machine which, by way of an intermediary piece of wood, transmits the unorganized and unconscious writing of the mediumistic hand onto a letter circle. And actually now I start to miss the mm-hmm. the slides because we could see here a lot.
Ну вот предыдущий пассаж как раз он подводил, пока пускаем то, что он хотел показать.
Gessmann did not, however, remain confined to these mediumistic writing devices, which largely conformed to Spiritism. The trained technician rather constructed an entire series of his own apparatuses which transcend the spiritist conception of mediumistic writing. Instead of recording occult otherworldly expressions of spirits, these apparatuses, which he called Emanulektoren, aimed for the obscure depths of the unconscious. And actually, here you will see machines that Gessmann constructed.
Однако Гессман не ограничил. И тут должно было быть как раз показ этих машин.
Yeah, and these emanulectors, they should, and I quote now Gessman, they should prove that the movements of the table or the communications resulting from the letter circle are actually rooted in a force emanating from the nervous systems of the medium, unquote. Gessmann then constructed his first apparatus around 1885. First accounts thereof are to be found in a paper written in 1886 entitled Thought Reading, Gedankenlesen, published in the Psychic Studies. And later he gave other accounts in 1819 and the last account was in 1897 in his book on psychography. It is conclusive that Gessmann derived some of his constructions from the so-called manometric table that, he says, Russian professor Mendeleev had built, and he was referring, everybody knows him here, to Dmitri Mendeleev, I hope I pronounced it right, Mendeleev?
That's right.
The famous chemist of St. Petersburg, who discovered the periodic law and optimized measuring devices such as the manometer. Apart from that, Mendeleev was the prominent chairman of the commission concerning the proof of mediumistic appearances, which in May 1875 had been instigated by the St. Petersburg University. Aiming towards a scientific examination of spiritistic phenomena, the commission turned to personalities like Aksakov, who disseminated spiritism in Russia. In March 1876, it concluded that, and I quote, spiritistic phenomena were caused by unconscious movements, or even more, by conscious deception, and therefore, spiritist teachings are to be considered superstitious beliefs, unquote. In this context, Mendeleev developed an apparatus with which, through a system of glass tubes, pressure that was expected on the expected on the table could be distributed and measured with manometers. And it's really a pity. There's a beautiful drawing of this table machine by Mendeleev, which you miss.
Это Камиль отметил, что у него как раз прекрасный слайд есть, посвященный этому, который вы сейчас увидите.
Drawing from this example, Gessmann now went on to construct his first emanulector in 1885, and also this you miss, in order to prove occult phenomena in an exact scientific way. As he says, this machine was to be capable of isolating the hand pressure exerted on the table from the movement of the table itself, thereby measuring the influence of psychic forces, in particular telepathy. In doing so, also Gessmann wanted to critically examine spiritism, which essentially led him to affirm the psychophysical thesis.
На основе этого примера, каким образом можно было измерить влияние психических сил, в частности телепатии. Сделав это, Гессман хотел критически рассмотреть спиритизм, который привел, и это привело его к подтверждению психофизического тезиса. Далее идет цитата.
Цитату мы не читаем.
Цитата и чертеж этой машины также были на слайде. Если появится все-таки электричество и будет время, то мы вам еще это покажем.
Okay. With this device, Gessmann thought to measure the strengths of the intellectual power which materialized in the disc's rotation. There is a disc in the machine that rotates, and on the disc letters of the alphabet are written, and thus they can be the thoughts can be made visible and can be read by the rotating disc. Okay, so with the help of this rotation disc, so he thought that it could make readable the thoughts. In parallel, this device was to filter out from the psychophysical experiment any external bodily force caused by the hand touching the table.
При помощи этого...
Skip the next part with... he constructed one machine after the other.
После того, как несколько друзей его к этому подвигнули, восприятию медиума.
Okay, I skip the last quotation.
Так, последнюю цитату мы тоже опускаем из выступления.
And come to a short conclusion, and I apologize for taking your patience.
Сейчас мы переходим к короткому заключению и приносим извинения за то, что ушло гораздо больше времени на выступление.
Gessmann's highly remarkable engineering activities clearly demonstrate the following tendency. The indirect psychography of the occult media technologies undermines the authority current in spiritism of otherworldly spirits as well as their corresponding personal media. Gessmann's media technological machine park mechanically disenchanted the spiritist hypothesis.
Технические разработки Гессмана, имевшие большое значение, четко продемонстрировали следующую тенденцию. Опосредованная психография оккультных медийных при помощи оккультных медийных средств подрывает авторитет спиритизма. И также подрывает веру в потусторонних духов и в соответствующие качества медиумов. Парк машин, созданных Гессманом при помощи механических средств, развенчал гипотезу спиритистов.
His occult apparatuses replace spirits and their physical media with a new psychic instance, the unconscious. According to the psychophysical thesis, however, this occult unconscious is a structure of forces with fine material nervous filiations, which are best recorded and deciphered with highly sensitive media machines, like the ones Gessmann developed. Precisely therein, occultism saw the great promise of soul machines, the writing up of the delicate flows of thought with even more refined recording and writing devices should make visible by way of technology that which escaped the grasp of the human senses.
Машины, созданные Гессманом для исследования оккультных явлений, заменили спиритов и их физических медиумов. На смену им они дали новый пример психической деятельности, бессознательной. В соответствии с психофизическим тезисом, однако, это бессознательно является структурой сил с тонкими материальными нервными окончаниями, которые лучше всего фиксируются и расшифровываются при помощи высокочувствительных машин, подобных тем, которые разработал Гессман. В этом, в частности, оккультизм увидел огромные перспективы для таких машин для регистрации души. И эта подводка к фиксации тонких потоков мысли на основе еще более тонких средств записи, регистрации и записи должна сделать видимыми те аспекты, которые ранее уходили от чувств человека.
Let me conclude with a very short epilogue.
И теперь очень короткий эпилог.
Gessmann's exact and scientific investigation of the occult unconscious with its hidden thoughts and nervous flows had a famous successor who pointed in a similar direction without relying, however, on the extensive use of machines. It was none other than Sigmund Freud. To be sure, Freud replaced Gessmann's recording systems, his psychographic soul machines, with the seeming simplicity of the analytic conversation. And yet, although psychoanalysis dispensed with any external technical devices, its psyche was, according to Freud's metaphor, understood as an apparatus with its own energy household and complex internal relations of force.
That's it.
Yeah, thank you so much. That's it. Thank you
for your hard work.
So, if there is energy here,
I mean, no energy.
We have to go to analogous communication and skip all the technical equipment.
Да, если у вас еще остается энергия. И мы могли бы в аналоговом режиме провести общение.
Actually, I personally would perfectly understand if there were no questions, but I see there are. Okay.
Я бы, конечно, вас понял, если бы не было вопросов, но вижу, что они есть.
Is it possible to create any equipment to communication with spiritual level of reality?